Today I'm delighted to share my most recent collaboration with an artist whose work I've long admired. Rebekah Meier has been designing products for our industry for a number of years, and today I count myself fortunate to create with her new Joggles foam stamps, which are debuting at 25% off. In today's video, I'll show you the new designs, talk about options for working with foam stamps, and I'll show you some samples created with them. We're debuting 14 foam stamps designed by Rebekah today, and I'm really excited to see the work of the last few months finally come to fruition. Like all of our foam stamps, these are just over half an inch thick, and they're deeply etched on our lasers here at the Joggles warehouse. Now, the thing that I like about foam stamps is how versatile they are. They work with lots of different kind of media. They can be incorporated into your projects in a lot of different ways. They focal elements, borders, layers, all of that. There are a couple of ways that I ink a foam stamp, and when I say ink, typically I'm working with paint, although you certainly can use ink from a pad, and there are some others that you can use as well. So when I ink, I'm going to do it one of two ways. I'm either going to take some paint and apply it with a Brayer, which means I can blend it or leave the colors a little bit more blocky, or once my paint is almost run out, what I typically do is, if it's not spread out, I'll spread it out with my finger and then just dip the stamp into it, and then the colors pretty much fall where they may at that point. So today I'm working with Pebeo's Iridescent Studio Acrylics and Finnabair's Art Alchemy Colors. Now the nice thing about paint is that once it's dry, it's done. It's not going to move when you put anything over the top of it, so your pattern, whatever it is, whether it's a leaf, or it's text, or it's this lovely design here that Rebekah has named Art, it's permanent. It's not going to move, and you can start to add things over the top of it, and you add more colors and more layers. And that's kind of what I did here. So if you look at this sample, lots of Art by Marlene stuff on it, fun things from the new Marlene's World die cut blocks. You can see that this one is called Square Lines, I think is the name of it. And it's very prominent in the background, but it doesn't overwhelm. Probably because I came in with similar colors and toned that white background down so it's a little bit quieter and it's not such a stark contrast. This is the same thing, although there's less of the stamp here. You can see it in this corner and this corner and a little bit here peeking underneath her hip. That's the one that's named Bright Star. And again, the color was on. I came and I added something over the top of it and nothing moved. Nothing not to like about that. So with that said, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. So let's come back and let me talk about other ways that you can do these. So you can see stuff that's been printed on plain backgrounds. These are the tags from Marlene's tag book. She's had two tag journal releases, and part of the release that happened with Marlene's World also included an essentials tag book that I'll show you in a little bit. So you can print on plain. This already had paint brayered on the background. Again, Bright Star when I printed that on. This is another one that was printed on a white background, and I came back with some oxide sprays. Now when you start working with these, you can see that I haven't finished this all the way, but all I did was come in with a pit pen and just very roughly outline, and then you'll notice there's some sparkle because I grabbed a color of stickles that matched the darker color, and I went ahead and just highlighted that. So once this other line of this design is called paper leaves. Once that's done, then this is ready to go. You can also stamp on pre-printed paper. So this is a little bit of a junky journal kind of tag book thing that I made a while ago. And you can see that it's got pre-printed pages in it. But this design is called, let me think about this, Starflower. And I printed half here and half here. And something you almost never see me do, which is to use a brown color, but it worked really well with this. So lots and lots of different options. Let me move some of these things out of the way. And I'm going to work with two colors today. I'm going to use the Pebeo number 359, which is iridescent green yellow. And I'm going to use the Art Alchemy color named Frozen Berries. So here are my two colors of paint. I have a Brayer ready to go. This is the small Brayer. You can see that it's pink. Everything else is dirty, but you can see the end. This is from the collection that Dina and Di share that is their gel printing products. And I've got one of Dina's palette knives because you got to have a way to get the paint out of the bottle. And I'm going to work with two stamps. I'm going to work, this is named Foliage and this is Paper Leaves. You saw that a second ago. So I've got a couple of tags that are already started. I'm going to work on the back, so ultimately I'll have some tags that have stuff on, or at least are started on both pages. So let's bring this over here. I'm going to squeeze out a little bit of the green. That should be plenty. And then I will put some of the frozen berries out. Grab my palette knife. Now this color is a little thicker than normal because this jar has been around for a while. So like most paint, anything that's been open will eventually start to thicken up. So you can stamp either the entire design or elements, and I'm going to do both for you. I'm going to show you how you can make this work. But first, let's get some color going here. So I'm going to get the green on one side of the brayer, and then we'll move paper leaves out of the way. I'm going to start applying color, and then I'm going to pick up frozen berries on the other. And this kind of lets me brayer colors on in blocks, and there is going to be some blending. I'm going to be careful not to overblend because, as you know, if I blend purple and green, it's not going to be pretty. All right, that looks pretty good. And again, you'll do a better job inking your or getting paint on your stamps than I am. So I'm going to print on this one since it's already got some green on it. But I'm going to print half on one side, and then I'll come back, and I don't think I centered this particularly well, but then I'm going to print half on the other side. Now, there's not a lot of leaves in nature that are green and purple, but I like this combination. It only has to suit me. The only person I have to make happy is me when I do this, and so that's generally what I'm trying to do. Whoops. Let's get some more of this on here. And then a lot of times what I like to do is just turn this around. This is just a background layer. That's all this is. It's meant to add a little bit of movement and interest and some different color. And I'll come over this with something else. So here we go. I like this design. It's very nature, obviously, inspired. Now, I don't want the paint to dry in here, so I'm going to grab a spritz bottle, and I'm going to spritz this with water and just put it face down out of the way so that it does not dry on there. Let's just wipe this up. Now, I've got a fair amount of paint left here, so I'm going to kind of spread the green out. I'm going to put out just a little bit more of the purple, and the other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take this, and I'm going to spray that off to the side, too, so that, again, the paint doesn't dry in the brayer. All right, I'm going to put out a little bit more of the frozen berries. I don't need a ton because I'm not going to do too much here, but I do want to show you the other option is always to just spread this paint out. Now, I've got a little bit of green here, so let's kind of refresh that, and now I'm going to grab... This is the one that's named paper leaves. So I'm going to very deliberately kind of let this go like this. So I've got green, purple on the top and then green. And then I'm going to just make a border with this. And I am going to start to let it fall off as we get closer to the bottom here. All right, so now I could also do this on the other side, but I kind of like that the way that it is. I'm not necessarily feeling like I have to do too much because this is a good spot for a figure, or I can put some text in here. So I'm going to leave well enough alone and just leave that be. All right, so let me go ahead and spray this, put it off to one side, and then I'm going to take a scraper to just kind of pick up all this excess paint because I do want to show you something about round designs because there are a fair number of them in this release. And then we're going to pull out some oxide sprays. All right, so there are, of the 14 designs in this release, there is paint all over my hands. There are 5 that are round. So this is named, let me think about this, this is named Starflower, and someplace here I have samples all set up so that I can show you, except that I can't really find them. This is the way it goes sometimes. All right, so here we go. Here's some. So this is that same combination of green and purple. This is Starflower. And then this one is named Bright Star. Now you've seen this because it was the background or part of the background in this Supersized ATC that I showed you earlier. And I thought someplace I had another, yes, here's another partial of that. And then up next, this is named Geoflower. And you can see that here. Again, very simple. This is something else that you could outline if you wanted to really emphasize that shape. Here's another example of Geoflower. Again, a white, oop, there's another Starflower. There, this was a white Supersized ATC. Once the paint dried, I put some oxide sprays over the top. So that's Geoflower. Coffee stain. Big, chunky coffee stains. Works really well. Again, I've got an area where I could work and I could put some text on there, or I could pick something as a focal element and let it live there. And then this last one is named Radar. Big, chunky. I want to say this is close to about 5.5 inches in diameter. Creates a nice gridded area, but it's round. So earlier I mentioned that when paint is dry, it's stable and you can come back and do some fun things with it. So I have... Let me see where I am here. Someplace here. Give me one second. Here it is. All right, so this is what I was looking for. So this is the one that I think is named Script. It's the only one that's very obviously text. If it's not named Script, it's got to be something similar. So this was Dragonfly in the Art Alchemy line and a pink in the Sparks line that I don't remember the name of. And I have just a couple of colors of Oxide sprays. I have Tattered Rose and Picked Raspberries. I'm kind of staying in the pink arena. All right, so when I do this, typically what I'm going to do is put a little bit of color on my nonstick craft sheet. And yes, this is the stuff we sell by the foot. My whole work surface is covered with it. I'm going to spritz it with a little bit of water. And I thought I had a bottle of Lindy's Starburst sprays out. Give me 1 second to reach one. All right. I'm going to throw just because why not? I mean, who says I can't, right? If I say it's okay, then it must be okay. So what I'm going to do is just come in and start tapping this color on here. Now, the thing with oxides is that they're obviously opaque, so some of the text may well disappear, but I'm okay with that. I'm just going to wipe this up because I'm not going to come back and dip it again. But if I think that this is a little bit too dark, it's just a simple matter to come back and to gently lift some of the color off. If I wanted to come back with a green and I don't have one handy, so let's use a little bit of yellow just because it's here. If I wanted to do this and just add some other color, I can come in and I can just drop droplets on there like that, and now I've got a very different look. It's all still warm and it all still works really well, and because that green in the background is dry, I'm not going to get any mixing or I'm not going to have any problems like that. So these are all additive techniques. I'm taking color and I'm adding it to a surface in some manner. Up next, I'm going to switch over to a gel press plate, and then we'll talk about subtractive techniques where we're going to actually lift color off the plate before we pull a print. Once I have a layer of color on my print surface, in this case a gel press plate, I'm going to use one of Rebekah's new foam stamps to remove color and pattern, which essentially is a subtractive technique. Even better is that when I've got paint on this surface, I can stamp it off so nothing goes to waste. I'm working with two Finnabair colors. I have Mermaid Teal and Crocus Fields. So I'm just going to kind of brayer them on in an ombre. Now, I have the backs of some of these others that I'm going to print on. I've got some of our white chipboard ATCs and supersized ATCs. And then, as I mentioned earlier, this is part of Marlene's new release that includes a whole book that's full of tags. Mine is falling apart because I started to pull pages out. But it's got tags with the three tab positions on it. So I'm going to print on those too. But before I do anything, I've got to get paint on the plate. So again, Mermaid Teal, this is a little bit thick from sitting, but it's fine. That's a little bit of a glob that we want to get rid of, but the rest of it is fine. And then I'm going to put out some of the Mermaid Teal, some more of the Mermaid Teal, and then I'll put out some of the Crocus Fields. And I'm going to let them blend just a little bit in the middle, which will give me that ombre effect. And I have a feeling that that might be too much paint, but we'll see how it goes. All right. Got the same brayer as I was using previously. I get these colors kind of moving here. And then I'm going to come over and grab the purple and let it just do its thing. And this is definitely too much paint, but make the best of it. It is what it is. All right. Nice thing is it's got little feet. I can turn it down like that. I can leave the paint on there. All right. So I'm going to use, this is named Butterfly Collage. So I'm going to come in and I'm going to use Butterfly Collage initially. And the good thing is that with all this paint, I have plenty of work time. So I'm going to pick this up and you can see that I've got this nice ombre on here. Let's see what we've got that's large enough. So I think I'll come in and I'm going to print this. Well, let's print half of it like this. And that was kind of a crooked print, but sometimes that's the way things happen, and we'll just get the other part of it there. And again, doesn't have to be great art, it just has to be something. Now I want to wipe the rest of this paint off, because the more paint that's on here, the less it's going to pick up. All right, so I'll come through and I'm going to do the same thing again. And these are cool because I can nestle them right next to one another. And then I'm going to do the same thing. Let's find a spot and print this one this way so I clean the whole thing off at once. And then I'm just going to come back and grab, How cool is that? Well, it's upside down. But how cool is that? It's a really nice design. And then I'm going to come in and grab this. All right. And this one I'm just going to quickly wipe off because I don't want to waste time here. And I'm going to be done with this, so I'm going to give it a light spray, place it face down. So now what I'm going to do is grab tags, and I'm going to print what's on here. So I'm going to print, and there's really not going to be anything else left that I could catch on here, so I'm just going to call that done, grab a piece of paper, and go ahead and print this. So, there you go. You can see that by subtracting the shape of the butterfly, what I'm left is what, and let me take this off before it sits here too long, what I'm left with is the remainder of the design that is the paint on the plate, and those areas are much lighter. In this case, they look white because the background I'm printing on was white. So if I want to do the same thing again, and let's just put a little bit more color on here. That's almost done. What do we got else? What else do we have? You know what? Let's bring in some of this frozen berries because it's a really cool color. It's lighter. It's kind of in that same family of purple, but it's lighter. And then I will bring in some more of the mermaid teal. And I'm going to just try radar right here in the center, just enough so that I can show you because it too is a nice big chunky design. And then we'll go ahead and get this brayered on and see what it looks like. All right, so I don't know how much of an ombre I'm going to get here because I kind of overblended these, but live and learn. All right, so this time I'm going to do half here, and I'm going to do half here. Now, I'm not picking or I'm not stamping the color off, but I'm about to. I don't know how much we're actually going to see, but we'll go ahead and stamp that on there. Not a whole heck of a lot, but again, it's just a layer in the background, so I'm going to call that done. Go ahead and give this a little bit of a mist so it doesn't dry, and then I'll grab some more pages here, and we'll see what we've got. We'll go like this, and then we'll go like this, and then go ahead and print. Okay, so not a ton. But then there wasn't a ton of paint on there, and obviously this is a little bit better because it was more in the area where the paint was. So these are Rebekah Meier's 14 brand new foam stamps with us here at Joggles.com. Lots of sizes, lots of shapes, lots of types of imagery makes them a wonderful resource, and they're debuting at 25% off.